Good evening all. On behalf of MMBA, I would like to extend my warm welcome to each and everyone present here to the Quin Decennial Lecture Series.
Honorable Mr. Justice T. Raja, senior members of our bar, Mr. Srinivas Raghavan, Jesse Jeevapriya, Mr. Ponnaya, Mr. T.S.R. Vengatramana, Secretary of WAA, Shivashankari, Secretary of MMBA, Mr. Ilango, Mr. Karunanidhi, Mr. Ganapathi Subramanyam, and all other advocates who are present here. Good evening to you all. Today we have gathered here for the third Quin Decennial Lecture Series. When we met Honorable Mr. T. Raja and invited him for the Quin Decennial Lecture Series, his lordship has readily agreed to deliver a lecture. But the only condition is that whatever the topic he is going to deliver a lecture, that it should be useful to the advocate community. So his lordship has given two topics. One is specifically fact, and we said this Land Acquisition Act 2013. Because this right to fair compensation and transparency in Land Acquisition and Resettlement Act 2013, to my knowledge, nobody has given any lecture on it. This is the first time MMBA has arranged in this topic. I'm grateful to your lordship, Justice Raja, for delivering. It's going to be a very, very useful lecture, and it should be very useful mainly to the youngsters, and so many cases are going to come on this topic, on this act, and it should be useful. There are more similarities between the old act and the new act, and also vast difference between the new act and the old act. So this lecture is going to be useful to one and all. I wholeheartedly welcome Honorable Justice T. Raja to this function and for this Quin Decennial Lecture Series. Next is, to achieve, today we amongst us, a new guest with us, to achieve anything, location should not be a barrier. Age is not a barrier, gender is not a barrier, and disability is not a barrier. And a living example is here. And our guest is Kausalya, who is working as an assistant in district court, and who has won 1 crore rupees in a Kodeshwari program at Colors TV. MMBA is having immense pleasure in welcoming Kausalya for this function. We want whatever any good thing is done or achieved, MMBA should extend their first arm in congratulating or in upliftment of that. So we are proud to invite and welcome Kausalya here for this function. I invite one and all who are present here for this third Quin Decennial Lecture Series and make it a grand success. Thank you.
It's time to honor. Now I request the General Secretary of MMBA, Mr. N. Ilango, to adorn Honorable Mr. Justice T. Raja with a shawl. I request President of MMBA, Senior Advocate Mrs. N. Krishnaveni, to deliver a memento to Honorable Mr. Justice T. Raja as a token of respect. Thank you, Lordship. Disability need not be an obstacle to success. Those words by Stephen Hawking still ring true. We have a live example to Hawking's words. It's none other than Kausalya Karthigeya, who is a winner of Kodeshwari game in Colors TV channel, hosted by Radhika Sharat Kumar. We are proud that she belongs to our hometown. I request the President of MMBA, Senior Advocate Mrs. N. Krishnaveni, to adorn Kausalya with a shawl. Next, Hon'ble Mr. Justice T. Raja to deliver a memento to Mrs. Kausalya Kartikeya. Right to fair compensation and transparency in Land Acquisition and Resettlement Act 2013 replaced the previous Land Acquisition Act 1894, which is nearly a 120-year-old law enacted during the British rule. MMBA has its own pride. After the amendment of this act, this is the first lecture taken on this act in and around Madurai, and Lordship is the first person to take a lecture on this topic. Now I request Hon'ble Justice T. Raja to take over the podium and deliver the Quin Decennial third lecture series.
Good evening to all of you. It is indeed a great moment to come and take part in this lecture series organized by MMBA. I thank the President, Mrs. Krishnaveni, Secretary Mr. Ilango, other office bearers, for having organized this very, according to her, useful topic for the members of the bar. As a matter of fact, this type of efforts initiated by the MMBA should continue for two reasons. One is, it is very difficult to study and find out several loopholes in some of the acts unless somebody comes and sits with you and teaches you on some of the gray areas. Very difficult to understand some of the provisions. Of course, a lawyer, we know. Repeatedly, if you read any act or any provision, at one point of time, a solution. But till then, you may have to pass through several days, months, and years. People used to say, the Rome Empire was not built in one day. It was built by years, ages. Julius Caesar was fighting with Britain, fighting with every countries, and ultimately he has conquered 3/4 of the global area. Ultimately, he was not able to go further because only 1/3 was left out. It was at that time he decided to name himself as emperor, Rome emperor. Then his Pangalis, indeed they are all family relatives, the royal family people, they conspire and ultimately brought an end to his empire. From day one, he was working hard. Ultimately, when the Roman Empire came to considered as one of the biggest empire, even the Great Britain used to afraid of this, Julius Caesar. It was not possible to build any kingdom in one day. Similarly, the advocates' wisdom, the knowledge which you are expected to keep with you in your mind, cannot be acquired in one day or 1 month or 1 year, but you have to all the time read, you have to self-educate yourself, you have to regulate your life. But in this context, I would say the MMBA has been standing apart, regularly organizing programs every year. I've been seeing, witnessing from sitting here, sitting at Chennai, only for the purpose of imbibing, teaching you the intricacies of the law. The benefit not only goes to you, but benefit ultimately goes to the the member in the bench, we, judges. One day, Justice Hegde was sitting, the former, the present Santosh Hegde's father. One Mr. Pandit Kanailal Mishra was arguing a matter before the Supreme Court. He was considered as a reputed and eminent lawyer. He went to UK to write ICS, but he was under compulsion to participate in the freedom fight, the India's freedom movement in UK, along with other freedom fighters. His name was listed out. He participated, he wrote the examination, ICS exam, but his name was withheld. Ultimately, people came to know on his representation that he got 150 out of 150 in English. One of the evaluator, after evaluating his question papers and answer papers, knowing that this man has excelled everybody, even in UK, the citizens, the British citizens, tracing out his origin, that he has come from Allahabad, the Allahabad University study, wrote a letter, that gentleman has written a letter, addressing the professor of the Allahabad University, saying that the British, as the Englishman, won India, conquered India, but this Kanailal Mishra has conquered English. So that was the greatness of this Pandit Kanailal Mishra, who ultimately gave a request to raise this issue in the Parliament, British Parliament, which we consider as the mother of the Parliament of the world. Then, when question was asked, people, speaker answered saying that he participated in the protest meeting against the Great Britain, therefore we were right in withholding his result, although he was able to succeed. Then ultimately he came back and practiced. When he went to Supreme Court, the judge was mentioning, after completing his argument, Mr. Pandit Kanailal Mishra, we are not able to see you often. Why don't you come to this court? Why don't you confine, base your practice in this court? He has mentioned, your frequent, continuous presence in this court will help us giving you qualitative judgment. Look at the way the judge was requesting a member of the bar. That should be the greatness. That should be the wisdom of a lawyer. That should be grown up to that level. It is possible only by way of organizing this type of good functions, good lecture series. That way, I congratulate the MMBA office bearers for having organized this lecture series. The reason for congratulating this MMBA office bearers who are presently holding the office is, you so much of concern on your members. Concern in the sense you go to the extent of even inviting a busy lawyer practicing in Supreme Court to come here to take classes, to teach you on some of the important issues. I recently came to know Mr. Gopal Swamy also came, and then Sekhar Nabdi is another very well-known lawyer. And then more than the standing the senior counsels, you have imported even a sitting judges of the Supreme Court also. Mr. Rohindan Nariman also, Justice Rohindan Nariman also came here a few years back, I was told. So the efforts which you are taking is really laudable, but you should continue. It is ultimately going to not only benefit the members, but also going to benefit the member in the bench also. Friends, today, the topic given to me is very useful topic. The scope and ambit of right to fair compensation and the transparency in Land Acquisition and Resettlement Act 2013. as a lawyer, as a citizen, as a student of law, you are bound to know this act. See, you may have a land. To preserve, to protect the land, you must know what is the act, what is the legal position. Leave alone, you need not own the land. You being a lawyer, people will be coming to take your opinion, whether a petition can be filed, how to save my property. My compensation has not been, you know, deposited or paid to me. To encounter successfully this type of questions, and also to win over your client, unless you say something which is giving some confidence to your, you know, client, you may not be able to get hold of any brief from your client. He will, you know, part with you immediately. So at least for the sake of enriching knowledge on this issue, which is very, very crucial, every time it is knocking at the doors of the Supreme Court, even today, the matter is pending. Although the Supreme Court has decided some of the very important issues, they are going to reconsider the matters. So therefore, rightly you have chosen a very prominent and important topic. I'm really happy to address on this issue. Friends, in the year 1894, India ruled by the Britishers had legislated the Land Acquisition Act 1894. It was an act made for our people, but it was made by the British rulers. You see, the act, the one word act, the Land Acquisition Act, that's all. If you see today, after 119 years, India has made the Land Acquisition Act. That is called the right to fair compensation, transparency in land acquisition, Rehabilitation and Resettlement Act 2013, that comes into effect with effect from 1/1/2014. Look at the date, year 1894, the act was enacted by our British ruler. We have thought over this matter, several loopholes, and I would tell you, it will be a great, you know, shock and surprise to all of you. The important special significant features made in this recent 2013 Act is really fabulous and immensely surprising everybody. When the original Act, Land Acquisition Act, was enacted, they never thought about your resettlement. They never thought about your rehabilitation. They never thought about the just and fair compensation payable to the landowners. They came and they thought, all right, we will have to administer it. We don't bother about the landowners. Look at the way in which they have acquired the land. Look at the way in which unreasonably they have knocked out the landowners from their own property. I tell you a small example. You, as a landowner, owning 3 acres of land. In fact, in my adjacent to my land, I just visited last week. My neighbor came and then he was discussing with me. We were taking sea water and, you know, the coconut, you know, water. He was cultivating onion in 3 acres. Today, the onion is in a great demand. Onion can be that this within 70 days the onion can be harvested. The gentleman says within 3 years time, within this, you know, 3 acres of land, 70 days, he has made 10 lakh rupees. It is true. Then I said, I will also go for cultivating the onion now. Then I requested him, why don't you, you know, copy, imitate our, you know, owner, our neighbor. And then he said that gentleman was advising us, sir, for onion, This is not the suitable time. You have to wait for 2 more months. After 2 months, then you have to go for that. Then we are waiting for onion to be cultivated now. Because in 70 days, you can get, you know, 10 lakh rupees from 3, you know, acres of land. For example, just you take this gentleman. This man is owning 3 acres. The government comes and acquire the land. Once the land is acquired, you take it from us. There is no guarantee that he is going to be given fair compensation to get somewhere resettled. Resettlement means, see, my land is taken away by the government, maybe for better uses, but where I will be going? That mentality was not thought of by those legislatures. The reason is, only a pittance is given. Many of us would be knowing, Mr. Venkatraman also must be knowing, when this land, the great, you know, place where our High Court is majestically standing today, and then thousands and thousands of lawyers are eking out your livelihood from this place, and lakhs of litigants are getting their relief every day from this, you know, place, is standing on the land acquired by the government. We all know that for almost 7, 8, 10 years, the compensation was not paid to the land owner of this place. Although we are dispensing the justice, that is the loopholes, the grave loopholes in the act that was not thought of, that was not embedded, that was not planted in that provision in the act. But thanks to the new act, this new act itself, the title itself, the name itself says that right to fair compensation. Look at the right to fair compensation, transparency in land acquisition, see, rehabilitation and resettlement. So many things. I would take you to several provisions. You'll be immensely happy. But how then you just, if you compare today's the provisions and the yesterday's provision of this, you know, Land Acquisition Act of 1894, you really feel very bad. How this act could be at all, you know, practiced, implemented in this, you know, great, you know, country. Initially, if you go back to this, you know, the Land Acquisition Act, 1894, if a collector and the tahsildar who is working under him are deciding that, for example, you and I are close friend of that tahsildar, or the close friend of that district collector, sir, you want to set up one public limited company. So why don't you just earmark some 10 acres of lands? The collector will say, what are you, you know, telling? What fool you are? You imagine 40 years back, land cost will, you know, go up. Instead of 10 acres, I will give you 20 acres, don't bother. Then he will just send the tahsildar to earmark a place without knowing whether it is a cultivable land or uncultivable land, waste land. He will go and choose some place according to his own convenience. And then he will come back and say, yes, the entire area has been earmarked for your friend's acquisition. Pittance will be paid to him. See, the collector will be writing a letter to the government, and the secretary may be also close friend of him. And he would say, in Madurai, there is no factory or industry. If this factory is now open, 100 employees will be employed, or 500 employees will be employed, and it is going to generate employment opportunity. The gentleman believing this word, and he will say, yes, you can go for issuance of 4-0 notification. So 4-0 notification is just like that issued acquiring a land belonging to you and me. After 4-0 notification, 6 declaration, declaring, yes, these are all the land is meant for the government. And then after 6 declaration, under section 11A, the collector, of course, section 5A, inquiry will be held, giving notice, asking them to come and take part in the inquiry. And then after the inquiry is over, then straight away you'll be passing award under section 11A. And then within 2 years from the date of notification, you should pass this award, and he just passes not all. Sometimes he may not even pass that award also. See, there is no guarantee that when award is passed, the compensation will be paid to you. Determination of compensation is the biggest challenge. He will not be using the guideline value or the market value. He will be just like that, he will be passing indiscriminately the award. Then the poor landlord will be getting that copy of the award. After going through the entire thing, he will be given only 10,000 rupees for, you know, one acre of land, or 1 lakh rupees for, you know, 2-3 acres of land. And then he will be making a complaint, look, in this area, the guideline value is this, or the market value is this. They will not listen to you. Ultimately, you have to make a request to him to make a reference to the reference code. The reference code, he has to come, he has to wait for ages. Ultimately, the reference code also will be increasing with all hesitation, only small amount. They don't bother about the guidance, the guideline value or the market value. Once that matter is taken to the High Court, the High Court will consider, the higher courts will consider the reasonable compensation. By the time, the children will not be able to pursue his studies. The marriageable daughters would not be able to see the light in their life. And ultimately, this man also will become old. This situation has been completely taken care of by the present, the new Act 2013. I tell you how. In the present Act, the law says, look, before going for issuing this notification, you must undertake a vast study, namely the social impact assessment study. Wonderful thing. If you just go through this in Act, the first step one has to do, collector cannot take away your land today, the land, the as per the provisions. Tahsildar cannot come nearer to your land. The government cannot come nearer to the land. The law is very strong. I tell you how. The Act says, before going to the issuance of this forum notification, namely under Section 11, you have to undertake what you call the social impact assessment study. That study will be undertaken, and then a report, a group of persons will be organized. It's a very long drawn process. To conduct the social impact study, the social impact, you know, assessment study, a social impact unit will be there. The government will be considering who will be becoming members in this unit now. That person who is going to become part of that, the, you know, the social impact, you know, assessment study group. A person who is not having interest in that area, in that land, should be a member. The several important officials will have to be part of the member, number one. Number two, that report will be submitted to the government. So the government will be considering the report, whether the report is properly made or improperly made. And then if the social impact assessment expert comes to the conclusion that it is a cultivable lands, a land irrigated multi-crop land, they may say, no, this is not fit for the, you know, land acquisition. If the social impact study group, the assessment group, expert group, says that it is not fit for acquisition, then you cannot move further as per the law. Then the area has to be identified by going to some other place now. That is very important safeguards. And then even if the social impact assessment study is made and the expert are making the report, and the report is either accepted or even the government also can differ. If the government can accept the report, they can go ahead. Only after accepting the report, then under Section 11, the notification will be issued saying that now we are going to acquire these areas. Very, very important thing. And after, before going to this, you know, Section 11, the social impact assessment group, that study group, they will find out what is the purpose on which we are going to acquire the land. If industry is going to come up, they will not acquire the land closer to the residency area. They got all the powers now. Now, ultimately, when the area has been earmarked and the expert says that this place is in a very, very, you know, cultivable land, three crops, you know, land, all the time water is coming. This is not, you know, this cannot be spoiled, then nobody can challenge it. That is one of the very good safeguard. We have got it now. And then another very important thing is, if you see the section, now there is one exemption. So far as this social impact assessment study is concerned, this has to be undertaken in every acquisition proceedings now. But this social impact assessment also can be dispensed with in a case where the government is going to invoke the urgency provisions. Urgency provision in the sense, if we see section 40 of the Act. Section 40 of this, the Right to Fair Compensation Act says that special powers are all given in the case of urgency to acquire land in certain cases. In cases of urgency, whenever the appropriate government so directs the collector, though no such award has been made, may on the expiration of 30 days from the publication of the notice mentioned in section 21, take possession of any land. Now, if for any reason a particular land is required for defense of India or national security or for emergencies arising out of national calamities or any other emergency with the approval of the parliament, in those circumstances, the Act says that one need not undertake the social impact assessment study, excepting in the case where the government is going to invoke the power of urgency. In all other cases, the study has to be done. Otherwise, the foreign notification can never be imposed, can never be released, can never be passed. Now, if the section 14 says, when a preliminary notification under section 11 is not issued within 12 months from the date of appraisal of the social impact assessment report submitted by the expert group, then the foreign notification also will lapse. This Act itself says that on four situations, the land acquisition proceedings will automatically will lapse. Which are all the four circumstances? But only in the old Act, we have got only one remedy under section 11A. If the award is not passed within 2 years, then it will go. But here is a case where, look at how the fairness has been expanded in this in a present Act. Under section 11, under section 14, if the assessment in a group, the social impact assessment report is submitted, and from the date of submission of the report, the government does not issue the foreign notification under section 14, then the report will go, and after the report is gone, then if you want to once again redo the exercise, you have to once again appoint the same social impact assessment group to study the situation, and then they have to go and meet the Gram Sabha, they have to go and meet the Panchayat president, and they should sit with them and find out, this is the industry going to come, this is the the project going to come, this is going to be useful to you people. If you are going to accept it, please, that will be going to help your villagers, that is going to help your entire people over here. Therefore, they should convince the people, and in case if they are raising an objection, the social impact assessment group expert, they should accept it and they should forward to the government now. So now, from the date of submitting the report, whether it is a right report or wrong report, even if it is a right report, it is acceptable report, yes, you can go ahead for acquisition of land. Within 12 months from the date of receipt of the report, the 40 the 11 notification, that is para materia to the 40 notification, should be issued. If not issued, then the entire land acquisition proceeding automatically will stand lapsed. And the second situation is, we all know, under section 24.2, this is a very controversial section that is in a pending consideration for the Supreme Court. There it says, if an award is passed under section 11 of the old Act, 5 years ago, or more than 5 years ago, the first situation is under section 24.2, there are two situations. One is, if any award is passed under the old Act, 5 years ago, or more than 5 years ago, prior to the commencement of the present Act. And the compensation is not paid to the landowner. A, compensation award is passed 5 years ago, that is, or more prior to the commencement of this Act, but the compensation money is not paid to the landowner, then the land acquisition proceeding will go. Or, award is passed, the physical possession of the land has not been taken over, money is also paid, but still, if the physical possession of the land, although award is passed, although the compensation is deposited, still the physical possession is not been taken over by you for more than 5 years, and it continues with the landlord, that indicates that you do not require the land. Therefore, under the premises, the section says that, again, for the reason that you have not taken physical possession of the land for 5 years from the date of the award, although it vests with the government, again, the land acquisition proceeding will lapse. So the third situation now. The fourth situation is, under section 25, if the collector fails to make the award within 12 months from the date of publication of the declaration under section 19, that is within 12, only 12 months only here. In every provision, in every where, they are saying that in the first occasion under section 14, within 12 months from the date of receipt of the report, social impact study assessment report, if you don't issue the forum notification, it will lapse. And the second situation is, see, award is passed, but after passing award in the old Act, not in the present Act. In the old Act, the award is passed, but 5 years ago, or more than 5 years ago, 6 years ago, 7 years ago, prior to the commencement of this present Act, and the compensation is not paid, or the physical possession of the land has not been acquired, again, once again, the land acquisition proceeding will lapse. And if for any reason the government wants to once again proceed with the matter, once again they have to go for appointing the social impact assessment study, and then they will be raising all objections. They may say no, they may say yes. So ultimately the social impact assessment group, the study is more important. They are not giving the power either to the tahsildar, the collector, or to anybody else now. Even the government cannot come into picture. One of the biggest safeguards given to the landowners now. And then the second, and the next one is section 96 of the Act, says that whatever the compensation you are going to get will be exempted from payment of income tax. But in the earlier Act, we find it very difficult. We cannot even sometimes order for exemption because income tax is more important, people used to say. But today, that argument one need not advance. Act itself gives you the liberty, that benefit, saying that under section 96, no income tax or a stamp duty shall be levied on any award or even agreement. For example, there is no any award. You as a landowner, I as a collector, sir, sitting together. Why this is social assessment study should be conducted? Not necessary. Then we will go for that. Why don't you give it to me? Because now the GH is situated, the Rajaji Hospital is built very closer to your property. Your property is lying waste. So why don't you give it to us? then you are agreeable. Yes, all right, instead of 2 crores, you give us enough 4 crores. All right, we'll sit, this is very prime land, give it to us. Even if there is an agreement. And on the agreement, the land is acquired by us. And the money is paid to the landowner. That is also exempted from these income tax provisions now. And this, the next one is very important. We used to argue left and right in the court. My Lord, the 4-0 notification has been issued for one purpose. After a long time, the purpose is gone, and they are going to use it for some other purpose. So the purpose for which the 4-0 notification has been issued, the purpose for which the 6 declaration has been issued, cannot be changed. And they will say that, no, that purpose may be a small purpose. Now the government is the person having the eminent domain. We are entitled to change it also. But that argument is not available to anyone today. Because section 99 says, the purpose for acquisition can never be changed. Look at it now. If you are saying that, now in Madurai district, there is going to be one central library, for example. That central library will be having 5-story building. One will be for the children, one will be for the old age people, one will be for the women, one will be for the students, one will be for the PG students, one will be for medical students. And that place we need, this is the best place. After some time, after the land is acquired, amount of compensation is everything is paid. If they are going to use it for building a medical college, Act says you can't change it. It is gone. So the only thing is, your tension is completely, the lawyer's tension, your hard work is completely taken away by the wisdom of the draftmanship now. The person who has drafted this act so cleverly, so intelligently, by using all his wisdom, has put into this provisions. And then it says, it was wonderful, find it very difficult. One judgment says today, another judgment says that no, the purpose can be changed now. But the law today is very clear. It says that once a land is acquired for one purpose, for example, the subcourt is going to be constructed. For the purpose of constructing subcourt, we are acquiring the land in Pudukottai. Then after acquiring the land, the award is passed. They are going to use it for some other purpose. Some other collectorate, or for expansion of the collectorate, for building the Tahsildar office, or any other purpose, a sports auditorium is going to come. That is also going to be useful to the public. But the law says, no, the purpose is one. You mention only one purpose. If that purpose is not going to be used for that land, then you are a man, unbelievable person. Therefore, we will not give this valuable land to that. So the act is very clear, 99. And very, very important salient feature is section 101 read with rule 20. 101 says it is another very gray area. It is not only a gray area, it is a very grave area where we have seen all the stalwarts used to come and then fight with the court. This land has been earmarked, you pass the award, it has not been utilized for 5 years, 10 years. Therefore, please give it back to the landowner. The government advocate, or additional GP or special GP will slowly rise from his seat and he will say, but now, this land we are going to use it for the people who are wandering here and there in the night. It is a night shelter, not this wonderful project. We are going to use it now. As though the court is going to accept it now. Now the purpose is one, when you put a question, not the government having the eminent domain. And you cannot challenge our power. What are you doing? We are going to use it for our playing carom. We are going to give it to the beggars, who are not having any shelter in the night time, during the holidays, during the winter time. They are all sleeping on the pavements. And we are going to use it. Your Lordship, keep the matter pending, then after 6 months we'll come back and it will be inaugurated only for this night shelter people. Court, the law says that 101 says, read with rule 20 of this act, the return of unutilized lands, if the land is not put to use for 5 long years from the date of taking possession, the collector can take back the land. One another very important thing is, a private entrepreneur comes and he says that I need 20 acres of lands. The 20 acres of lands are acquired and given to this the private partner, private company. These people out of 20 acres are using only 5 acres. And then 15 acres, you people, I do not know whether you know or you do not know. If you go into details, the private entrepreneurs, they used to get more lands, use only one third, and three fourth of the land, they will not be using it, they will be selling it out for higher prices. This is the reason why all the checks have been put in this present act now. Now, in this case, 20 acres have been acquired and given to the private entrepreneur. Out of 20 acres, this man has utilized only 5 acres of lands, and the 15 acres of lands, or 10 acres of lands, for example, or even 5 acres of lands have not been utilized. He has put up a wonderful compound, very huge compound. Either the 5 acres or 10 acres or 15 acres of lands are lying idle. 5 years, these lands have not been utilized. The Act says, 101, read with Rule 20. Collector, you have the power. Look at the great provision now. The collector can straight away go, issue notice, and call for explanation. Look, we have given you this land, acquired this land. Of course, you have paid compensation in those days, 5 years ago. After 5 years, you have not utilized the entire land. And you have utilized only one fourth or one half of the land. And the rest of the land is just lying. Why I cannot take it back and give it to the landowner? Please give us explanation. And he will say that I have utilized only this much, and the rest of the land I am going to utilize for the next next phase. Collector will not accept it. The reason, the yardstick is, if the land allotted to him has not been utilized for 5 long years, then on the expiry of 5 long years, the collector and also the landowner can work together. He can make an application, not to the High Court. He can make an application, one page application to the collector, citing this 111 provision, saying that as per this provision, 111, 101, read with rule 20, please, you redeem the land, please give it to me. And the landlord is prepared to deposit the money, not the solution. By the time you must have received the compensation, by the time you must have received the solution. But the law says that if that person in whose favor the land acquired and given has not utilized the land, and the unutilized land, either the entire land if it is not utilized, that also can be taken back and given back to the landowner. Even if some portion, in the sense some sizable portion, unutilized portion of the land is unnecessarily lying with that the person, the requiring party, the requisition party, then the collector, after giving notice, take the land, give it back to the landowner. There one astounding provision is this. The Act says, Rule 20 says, if that requiring body is opposing this collector, creating some problem, the provision says the collector can take the aid of executive magistrate and also the police, concerned police. With the force of the police, he can take away physically, he can forcibly take over, and he can hand it over to the landowner. I don't know how this type of provision has come out. Great provisions. And then if you read the rule 20 of this act, it says very interesting. And it takes so much of time to understand how this type of wisdom cloth provision has been brought in this rule. Rule 20, subclass 3. If the land is being returned to the original owner or owners or their legal heirs, as the case may be, the compensation paid to them excluding the solatium shall be returned and deposited by them in the designated account of the office of the collector as specified by him before taking possession of the land. And the amount so refunded shall be used towards a development. That is also not very important, but rule 20 subclass 4 says if the requiring body does not hand over possession of the said land to the collector shall be competent to take the help of the concerned executive magistrate and police force to take the possession after giving prior notice to the requiring body. And it also says that when any land acquired under the Act remains unutilized for a period of 5 years, as referred to in section 101, the same shall be returned to the original owner or owners or the legal heirs, as the case may be, by issuing a notice only to the requiring body for whom the land was acquired, and by giving an opportunity of being heard, and by passing necessary order in writing by the collector in this behalf for this purpose. So the collector has got all the powers. The only thing is we have to meticulously follow whether the time frame stipulated by the provision has been followed or not. In case if for any reason 1 month is elapsed, 5 years is gone, you are entitled to repossess the land, and the Act is very clear. And we need not undertake any huge homework. The judges need not refer to any judgment. The judges need not unnecessarily wait for any judgment to be produced by the lawyers now. We can just simply come to the court saying that, look, 101, I read with rule 20. It says that if the land acquired has not been utilized 5 long years, I am entitled to get back. I am the person, I am the owner of the land. I am prepared to give back my compensation, but I am not entitled to return that solatium. Solatium, you are entitled to keep it with you. It's a punishment. So wonderful provisions have been come out in this provision, in this Act. And there are some more provisions. It is really, if you go through that, it's really surprising. What is more important to all of us is, if the government is going to acquire land for the public purpose, as I mentioned to you, the social impact assessment study has to be conducted. And if for any reason private entrepreneurs are coming to set up a factory or industry or company, there the Act says, if you are going to acquire 100 acres of lands, either in Madurai or Ramanathapuram or Sivagangai, the affected person's consent is required for the purpose of giving land to the private owners now. Look at the heavy conditions put against this, the government. The government, if you are going to give 100 acres of lands by acquiring from the land owners to the private entrepreneurs, 80% of the consent from the affected person should be obtained. And in the case of the private and the public entrepreneurs partnership, 70% of the consent are required. If out of 80%, 2% are not coming forward, entire proceedings will go away. I don't think that the government can give any better safeguard, any better safety walls to safeguard the land and the landed property. And then very important, another interesting aspect is, if the collector is passing an award, after passing an award, he has not taken into account the guideline with the market value. The salient feature in this Act is, collector passes an award. As a lawyer, you must understand, when the collector passes an award, the old stories are all gone back. Just like that, blindly going there and then collecting this 10,000 rupees, take it away. He has to apply the guideline value. He has to apply the market value, The market value, and the very, very interesting aspect is, the market value of the land has to be ascertained you know how he has to ascertain? Guidelines are all given now. Stamp duty, how much he has paid, and when some land is purchased or sold, in the registered document, what is the market value mentioned? All these things ought to be properly seen. And thereafter, when the market value is taken, it says, better go to Schedule 1. Schedule 1, it says, there is a pointer to be applied, multiplied. See, market value, giving market value itself is a great affair. It's a very interesting, welcome step. But the Act says, you first of all, you work out the market value as per the provision given in this Act, Section 26. And then after working out the market value, this is the market value, then that will be multiplied. It's a great solution. It is great to benevolent provision given to the land owners, because they have given so much of importance to the land owners and the land. And then in case if the collector fails to follow any one of the articles, he is working out only the market value, but he is not applying the multiplier. For example, if he is applying multiplier, I am entitled to get 1 crore rupee for my land. But if he apply the multiplier, I am getting 4 crores. If he is not applying the multiplier, then you need not even come to any court. There is one authority. That authority is generally man by a person who is a retired DC judge or a very seasoned lawyer, having 10 years of practice. The qualification for the person who is going to man the authority is this, and then you can just go to the authority against the correctness of the award, and then you can argue the matter saying that the compensation has not been properly paid, the land extent has not been properly ascertained, because my land is 5 acres, but he has given compensation only for 4 acres, he has not properly measured. So all these aspects you can agitate before the authority that has been formed under Section 51. That authority can set aside that award. After setting aside the award, direct the collector to redetermine the compensation. And then, if for any reason, the authority also working out all these things and gives you something that is also not satisfied by you, then the Act says, under Section 74 of the Act, appeal provision is there to the High Court. So you can go to the High Court. So first is the collector will work out the market value, and then the multiplier principle will be applied, and then thereafter, if you are disagreed, if you are not acceptable, if you are not accepting that award, if you are aggrieved, then once again you can go to the authority under Section 51 and the 51 and 64, and then thereafter, if the authority is also not determining the compensation and there is a infirmity or there is some mistake, then as against that award passed by the authority, you can also file an appeal for redetermination of the compensation within 6 months' time. For redetermination of the award, you can go to the High Court. And the provision says, within 6 months from the date of filing this petition, filing this appeal, it has to be disposed of. It's a very important thing. Everywhere the check and balances are given now. The High Court has to dispose of that matter within 6 months. Olden days, matter is pending for 10 years, 5 years are all gone by. You can't just like that. You must know that once you file it, you cannot sleep over this matter. Poor client will suffer. You must know that from the date of filing, 6 months is not gone. You can just go and mention the matter. Look, Lord, this is the position, and let us give life to this provision now. And the court is bound to take up the matter and give a disposal either this way or that way. These are all the salient features. More interestingly, if I tell you, in the old Act, the Land Acquisition Act, 1894, if a person comes, Tahsildar or the collector, he comes and makes some wrong statement. This is the way I have worked out the compensation. And if the court finds that the collector has committed a mistake, or the Tahsildar has not to properly apply his mind, there is no provision to find fault with him now. But in the present Act, it says the court can give a direction to the government to take action against Tahsildar action against the collector who has passed the wrong award. Not only the direction to initiate dismissal proceeding, the court also says that for making a false case, he can be the person whosoever is found guilty can be sent to jail imprisonment. This kind of a provision I never come across anywhere. Only thing is you have to read through that and then keep ready. Whenever brief comes, then you have to just apply the proper provision and then the order will be at your hand and there won't be difficulty. And the more interesting thing is, if anybody is making a false claim, see, it goes to different dimensions. A person who is a private entrepreneur, he is coming and making a false claim. I want this 10 acres of lands. And then he has utilized only 5 acres. 5 acres, he is keeping it only for the purpose of resale after 5 years when the market rate is going up. It is a false claim. It is, of course, it is non-cognizable. It says that very clear, everywhere it is saying, it is non-cognizable. But once you are making a complaint, it is a cognizable. Action has to be taken. And then the imprisonment. If an officer is not doing well, disciplinary action will be taken, sent to jail, 6 months imprisonment. And similarly, if a person comes to the court saying that I am the owner of the property and my property has been unnecessarily knocked away, finally, if that property does not belong to him but it is a Perambok property, Perambok land, he can also be taken for a task. He can be dealt with. So everywhere the provisions, safeguards are all given in the present land acquisition, right to free compensation, right to fair compensation act. How much time? And there is one another surprising news from this in a book. A poor person belonging to a settled caste and settled tribes community is having a land. The act says he cannot acquire the land. The land belonging to settled caste and settled tribes cannot be acquired. But if the heaven is going to fall down, for example, one aerodrome is designed, or a military, army aerodrome has to be built up, maybe in Tanjavur. It has been inaugurated. Adjacent to that aerodrome, some lands are all there. It is very risky if the lands are not acquired. For the safe and safety, security of the nation, integrity of the nation, sovereignty of the nation, that land also has to be acquired. Only under these very, very compelling circumstances, if the land has to be acquired, for no, there is no other go. Only in those circumstances, the land can be acquired. If the land is acquired, the act says, he is coming from the backward community. Please allot the equal land to nearby place, alternative land should be given now. And I don't think that anywhere in the world this type of provision would be there. So much of wisdom cloth provision is there everywhere. And if you read it, I don't think that you will leave this book even for a while. Before completing the book, I don't think that you will be able to rise from the place. There are so many surprising provisions meant for the land owners, the land users. And then I was really, really happy to read one of the very interesting provision, section 9 and 10. Section 10, it says that no irrigated multi-cropped land can be acquired. In the previous old act, whether it is cultivable land, or if that land is lying closer to the water carrying channel, all 365 days the water is coming near Tamrapurani, don't bother. You acquire the land, spoil his livelihood now. But here is a case, if the land is irrigated all the time, three crop land, look at it. Look at the wording used now. If it is three crop, And if you are able to procure, get a, you know, a paper, adangal, and then, you know, adangal from the tahsilda, the VAO, saying that all, you know, three crops you are, you know, getting from the particular land, that is a good ground, the tahsildar will not accept it. The social impact study group will not accept it. They will recommend your case not to acquire the land. If there is any, you know, if anybody is coming forward to acquire the land. So these are all the very interesting provisions given to the people. And if you go through all the provisions dealing with the several unforgettable provisions, I would say this act should have been enacted, brought into effect from the day we got independence in 1947. Have we brought this act long time ago, perhaps we would have really grown up two times more than what we are today. In fact, Barack Obama, when he was re-elected on the second term, he was invited to address the mother of the parliament, British Parliament. In 2016, he went, and it is one of the honored place, privileged parliament. Only in the history of British Parliament, they have invited only two persons, Nelson Mandela and the Queen. The British Queen used to go and address. The third important person was Barack Obama. When he went there and addressed the nation through the parliament, he said, today, socially, politically, scientifically, technologically, several countries are growing up by leaps and bounds. But three countries are going with the highest speed, which we are not able to catch, we are not able to pursue behind them. They are, first is China, the second is India, the third one is Brazil. And he was giving the reasons why he was citing this country, the India, as the second fastest growing nation. He was saying, India's, the government policy is open policy. They are all living like an open society. A liberalized policy, trade, commerce, everywhere they got liberalized. People in Bombay can bring their goods to Madurai and they can sell it. People from Madurai, they can take, they can carry their goods, either whatever the fruits or whatever the things you are manufacturing or making in this place, by catching hold of this train, you can go. Just like that, you can go, you can sit in the platform, you can sell it away. You can just get that for half a day, you can get the platform ticket, you can sell it, you can come back. This is how the India has grown up. In 1947, when we got independence, 15th August, friends, you must understand one thing. Keep it in mind. India was not having even one single car factory. In the year 1942, India was having only one car factory, that's Hindustan Automobile Factory, that was set up in the year 1942 only for the purpose of manufacturing the automobile components, not for making car. We got independence in the year 1947. Mr. Venkatramanan is very keenly looking at me, but it is a true story of our history now. After 2 years from the date of we got independence, the year 1949, the first car was rolled down on the street, that is called the Fiat car. The Hindustan Motor Company has produced in the year 1949. We got independence in 1947. Today, friends, we have been manufacturing satellites, like children's toys. Every country is booking Indian company, Indian satellites, are the most precious, more trusted satellites. And we have been selling, see, for a cheaper rate to every country except China, Russia, and US. All countries are all standing in queues. And we have been growing to the greater extent now. The reason being the liberalized policy. If you want to set up your education institution, school, kindergarten, college, engineering college, medical college, if you have your wherewithal, if you have the resources, the government says, yes, please come forward. 1947, we got independence. Only three countries were able to send their satellite, their rocket to moon. And we have chosen the place where nobody has thought of landing. The southern portion of the moon, nobody was ever thinking, people willing to take any risk. But our people, they have chosen that in the southern side where nobody has landed, either Russia or China or America did not think of landing over there. We have chosen our Chandrayaan number 2, and we landed over there. And we have accepted to the entire world. See, knowledge-wise, India is nowhere inferior to anyone. And we have stand up. And today we are standing. It is a full proof. I can tell you one more very interesting aspect. President Trump, he is no doubt ruling the US. Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi, he is ruling India. We have recently have seen Narendra Modi goes to US. He meets Sundar Pichai, who was born in Madurai. And today he is the chief CEO, of this Google. See, Google, the very important aspect is, if you are getting up in the morning, you have to go to the restroom to pick up your toothpaste and toothbrush. You are under compulsion to clean up your tooth. I hope you will do it every day now. Twice the dentists are advising us to use the toothbrush. Without using the Google, no man in the world can just work or go to bed. Today, this Sundar Pichai was born in Madurai, fortunately. And this gentleman, the entire world. The reason being the background that has been given by this, the government, state government, central government, is responsible for all of us to stand together and stand up on a higher footing. I believe that this type of very innovative laws, legislations, are really going to lift the nation to the higher levels. And for that, I request all of you, you must spend some time. What is a law? As a lawyer, you must understand. Very difficult to understand, but if you read repeatedly, twice, thrice, fourth time, fifth time, I don't think that you need any guidance, because they're all used in a very, very simple language. You'll be able to get wonderful exposure, and with that you'll be able to help your client, and ultimately the law will be laid with all your assistance. Thank you for the opportunity given to me. Once again, I wish this legacy should be carried forward by this MMBA. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Lordship. You gave us a clear distinction between the old act and the present act and its application, and the checks to prevent the sale of unutilized lands and how the landowners can restore their lands. Now I request the General Secretary of MMBA, Mr. N. Ilango, to propose the thank vote.
Andisayum in the Arumayana Poladil, Andror Sunda in the Avaye Vanangi Mangirin. MMBA Sarbaha, Yerpad Sayapate, Serapaha Nadai Betruvarum. தொடர் கருத்தரங்கில் முத்தாய்ப்பாக இன்று நமக்கெல்லாம் கிடைத்த ஒரு நல்வாய்ப்பாக மாண்புமிகு நீதியரசர் திரு டி ராஜா அவர்களின் மூலம் நில எடுப்பு சட்டம் பற்றி நாம் அறிந்து கொண்டதாகும். இன்றைய நம் சிறப்பு விருந்தினர் நீதியரசர் திரு ராஜா அவர்கள் நம் இதய சிம்மாசனத்தில் அமர்ந்து நம் உள்ளத்தை ஆட்சி செய்யும் ராஜாவாகவே மாறிவிட்டார். நமது வளாகத்தில் நடைபெற்ற பொங்கல் விழாவில் நம் நீதியரசர் அவர்கள் சரியான நேரத்தில் மேற்கொண்ட சரியான முயற்சியினால் அந்த விழா சிறப்புற்றது என்பதை நாம் யாரும் மறந்துவிட முடியாது. ஒரு தந்தையை போல கண்டிப்புடனும் தாயை போல கனிவுடன் ஐயா அவர்கள் நமக்கு அளித்த அறிவுரை மதிப்பிட முடியாததாகும். அதற்காக நாம் என்றுமே நன்றி கடன் பட்டுள்ளோம். நன்றி ஐயா. மேலும் இன்று நீதியரசர் அவர்கள் கருத்துரை ஒரு விரிவுரையாளரை விட ஒரு பேராசிரியரை விட மிகவும் அருமை. அதற்காக ஐயா அவர்களுக்கு எம்எம்பிஏ சார்பாக மனமார்ந்த நன்றியினை தெரிவித்துக் கொள்கிறோம் ஐயா. மேலும் இந்த நிகழ்விற்கு வருகை தந்து சிறப்பு செய்துள்ள எம்எம்பியின் மூத்த உறுப்பினர்கள் திரு டிஎஸ்ஆர் வெங்கட்ரமணா அவர்களுக்கும், திரு சீனிவாச ராகவன் அவர்களுக்கும், திரு கணபதி சுப்பிரமணியன் அவர்களுக்கும், திரு கருணாநிதி அவர்களுக்கும், திரு பன்னீர்செல்வம் அவர்களுக்கும் எம்எம்பிஏ சார்பாக நன்றினை தெரிவித்துக் கொள்கிறோம். மேலும் பெண் வழக்கறிஞர் சங்கத்தின் செயலாளர் திருமதி சிவசங்கரி அவர்களுக்கும், உமன் எம்பவர் கமிட்டி சேர்மன் திருமதி ஜெசி ஜீவப்பிரியா அவர்களுக்கும், வழக்கறிஞர் ஜெயேந்திரா பட்டேல் அவர்களுக்கும் நெஞ்சார்ந்த நன்றியினை தெரிவித்துக் கொள்கிறோம். மேலும் வருகை புரிந்து சிறப்பு செய்துள்ள அரசு வழக்கறிஞர்கள், சக வழக்கறிஞர்கள், சகோதர வழக்கறிஞர்கள், இளம் வழக்கறிஞர்கள், பத்திரிகை மற்றும் ஊடக நண்பர்கள், எம்எம்பிஏ பணியாளர்கள் ஆகிய அனைவருக்கும் நெஞ்சார்ந்த நன்றியினை தெரிவித்துக் கொள்கிறேன். நன்றி, வணக்கம்.